Can you talk a little bit about what specific skills an academic needs to have in order to successfully transition over into the industry?
Sure. One of the biggest things that happens for academic scientists is during their academic career, they're generally working kind of in isolation. There's not a lot of training in working in cross-matrix environments where you have to interact with more than scientific peers. You have to interact with project managers, with salespeople, with senior executives. And the kinds of communication skills you need to do that and to prioritize things in a way that's important for driving the company forward are different than the kinds of prioritizations that students typically go through when they're in an academic environment.
Are all academics able to make that transition?
I never say all. I mean, I think that there are people who are best suited for academic careers, for sure. But I also think there are people who have excellent potential skills, if they just learn and develop those, that can have very, very productive careers in industry that can be just as exciting, both intellectually, productively, and financially, as the kinds of careers they can have in academia. And that breaks, you know, some of the myths about how industry can be boring, it can be you can't develop, and those things which just really aren't true.
In many cases, when academics, you know, commercialize their intellectual property and become CEOs of a company, after a while, sometimes, you know, VCs will come in and say, maybe it's time for a person with business experience to come in. How would you advise a academic turned entrepreneur in that situation? How hard is it to let go for some of these people?
Well, actually, there's a program that started over in Maryland called Innovate. It's an entrepreneurial program that sort of is geared towards that. The idea is to take technologies that come out of places like Johns Hopkins or NIH or University of Maryland and marry the inventors of those programs with business entrepreneurs or entrepreneur students to actually make a go of starting a business. Early on, you know, and when you're first starting a business, everybody wears a lot of hats. So typically what happens is when a company first starts, the CEO or CSO of the company also is oftentimes either the inventor or somebody very close to the invention. But as the business needs of the company evolve, as that fledgling company starts moving, then typically what happens when you, as you said, when you get investors coming in and giving you startup money or seed money, then they want to put somebody in place who really understands the business drivers. And, you know, a lot of times without training, scientists just aren't prepared to make the kinds of decisions you have to make in order to make a business go.
In your training workshop today that you're going to deliver at the University of Minnesota, what are the top five things that you think people should take away from your lecture?
So, just to be clear, the focus of the workshop is to get academic scientists to start thinking in terms of what do you have to do, what's different about the job culture in academia versus industry. And what that really means is understanding the importance of what we call core competencies, these transferable skills that we've reduced it down to about 24 that are critical for being successful in industry. And they're around, you know, creating the vision, strategic thinking, advanced communication skills like style, flexibility, emotional intelligence, social intelligence, technical literacy, innovation, and then project management, financial skills. The reality is a lot of those skills they actually have experience with. Part of it's just not understanding the vernacular. And so what we try and do is first get them to identify and understand what these skills are, then relate their own experiences as academic scientists to those careers so they get a better sense of what they're good at, right? And we also can provide a self-assessment that they can go through so they can understand what their own skills are, how good they are at them, and develop what we call an experience statement. So they have, if they gave themselves a 4 in social intelligence or in empathy or rapport, they have an experience statement that says, when I was a postdoc, I had high school students in the lab and I taught them my own assays that I developed because I wanted to also help them develop. Well, that's a really good example of enabling, right, and rapport. And those can be good examples to use in developing customized resumes and getting ready for interviews for the kinds of legitimate examples you can give of how you understand the core competencies that are important in industry. Because the reality is when, you know, when a Pfizer looks for a molecular biologist, they're going to get 500 people applying as molecular biologists for that position. And really, from a scientific technical standpoint, they're all pretty indistinguishable. Let's be honest, if you've done a PhD in molecular biology, you know molecular biology. You can clone, you can do the things that are, you know, that are associated with molecular biology. What generally differentiates them is their ability to demonstrate some of these additional skills, communication skills, understanding of the fact that a business has to make a profit, has to remain competitive, you know, and those are the kinds of things that are going to give you a competitive advantage, not just in getting a job, but then being successful in that job.
Thank you so much for your time today.
Okay.